It's time for Boots and Armchairs,
a treasure hunters podcast.
I'm going on an adventure!
It's another Bobby Dazzler!
A real life buried treasure.
One of the most famous uncracked codes of all time.
Let's go find the treasure!
Hello and welcome back to Boots and Armchairs,
a treasure hunters podcast.
We are your hosts, Deidre and Dustin White.
Hi.
Hi.
How's it going?
Good.
Are you super stoked to be here like I am?
I'm super stoked that it's episode 4 and we are going to be having Sandra Miller with us today.
She's a writer and I read that she's a teacher and we know that she's a treasure hunter, right? So
yes.
That's what her book's about. This is a book released next week called Trove.
It's going to be released on 9/19/19. Talk like a pirate day.
Is it?
Yeah.
For real?
Arr, matey.
Yeah, we've read a little bit of her book, and I know that there's some pirate stuff in there. So maybe that's intentional. Maybe that's a clue.
Could it be?
Could it be?
A clue? Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
Maybe we'll ask her.
That's a good idea.
Okay. The hunt is located in the Northeast in the New England area. I mean, anybody could buy the book. Anybody can participate. You know, anybody could try to crack the clues, but you have to go, from what I understand, you have to go to this place somewhere in New England to find this thing. So we'll talk to her more about that as well.
I'm excited to get chatting with her.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll talk about this a little bit more during the interview, but I have started reading the book and I enjoyed it a lot. It's quite good.
Yeah, I also got a good chunk of the way through it. I can't wait to finish it. It's a great story. This is a memoir of hers. She spends a lot of time treasure hunting in it. I feel like now my memoir would include a lot of treasure hunting.
Very likely. Before we get to the interview with Sandra, I just want to know, what treasure hunts have you worked on this week?
Oh, this week, it's been a busy one. Worked a little bit on the Oracle.
Oh, good. That's a new one to us.
It is. Kind of got a little bit of energy from that last interview.
Yeah, that was a fun one. Thanks again to Nick and to Robert.
Thanks, guys, for opening our world.
I haven't looked at it yet, but I'm excited to, and it will happen very soon. But beyond that, I've studied The Secret.
Of course.
You know that? You know that one?
I do know that one. I may have heard of it once, twice, maybe 12 times.
Just 12?
Just 12.
Okay, well, I've been working on it like all week. You know, that one just takes over my brain. When I have nothing else going on, The Secret is going on in my brain.
So, are you saying you often have nothing going on in your brain?
No.
You totally set yourself up for that one. When I have nothing going on in my brain, I just think about stuff.
I think about The Secret.
Ah.
Okay, so I do think about stuff all the time, I guess, okay? But I'm so deep into that one that even when I'm busy, I can think about it. That's what I mean.
Okay, but I have to remind you, sometimes the best thing to do in order to progress yourself in a treasure hunt is to look at a new one for a while.
Okay.
Fresh eyes.
Do you have a suggestion for a new one?
Well, my suggestion would be to dive deeper into this new one and the Oracle, of course.
Okay, well, I'm looking forward to Trove and the Oracle. I think we might be ready to bring Sandra on.
Yeah, let's go ahead and grab her. Sandra, thanks for joining us.
Oh, you're welcome. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, thanks for being here, Sandra. We're excited to chat with you about your new book.
Being a treasure hunting podcast, and we're diving right in, we'd be in big trouble if we didn't ask you, why did you craft a treasure hunt to go with your memoir?
Right. Well, the experience of going on an actual treasure hunt was the thing that inspired a deeper search for me.
Mm-hmm.
And that was really, I was really looking for a connection to my mother, my place in my family, a more fulfilling creative life. And so, in many ways, this treasure hunt that I go on, that I take in my memoir, led me onto this bigger search. I love the experience of treasure hunting. I love the way it makes us feel alive in the world,
mm-hmm.
alert to things. We spend so much time staring at our phones, and when you're on a treasure hunt, you actually have to look up and look out and see the world as offering clues. So I love that experience, and I wanted my readers to have some version of that experience and maybe get them hooked on treasure hunting, too.
That's one of my favorite things about treasure hunting. Like, how often are we out in the world and, you know, you've read one of these things, and everything must be a clue, right? We all have a good story.
That's exactly how it works. It just makes you pay attention. You think, what about that rock over there? Why is that fence twisted? And when you start thinking with the mentality of a treasure hunter, that's right, everything becomes a clue. Life becomes a treasure hunt.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, it's funny. Before I started really getting involved in treasure hunts myself, I wouldn't consider myself a very creative person, just going, you know, normal daily stuff. Now that I research all of these things and look at images that are provided, you know, by the people that hide these treasures, and it, you know, you have to really be creative in the way that you look at these things as a whole. You know, if you turn a picture, you know, with clues in it on its side, it becomes a whole different perspective, right?
It's exactly.
It gives you just a whole new outlook on everything. So, you know, that's something we see in our searches every day.
Yeah, nothing is as it seems when you're looking at the world and searching for treasure. Nothing is as it appears, and that's one of my favorite things about it.
And I can see where that would really dive into that deeper search that we see within your new book. I haven't finished it yet, but what I've read, I love.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, I started reading it as well. Last night, we had quite a busy past few days, but I started reading it late last night, and I literally was up till 4 o'clock in the morning continuing to read. I only got maybe about a third of the way through the book, and I kept stopping to like research things that I had seen as far as, because you go on a treasure hunt in the book.
Yep.
And so I wanted to know kind of what you were looking at, where you were, you know, those kind of things. So I had a lot of fun reading a good chunk of the book last night.
Oh, that's great. I love hearing that.
Yes, I definitely started looking up those locations too. Total treasure hunter mindset.
Yep.
Where are they?
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, we've been to Brooklyn, and that's where you go and look for a treasure in the book, at least in the opening chapters. So it was just a fun,
way to connect.
Yeah, and it was just a fun thing to kind of try to wrap my brain around where you guys were and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we spent a lot of time searching through parks in Brooklyn.
And I bet you so many stories.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's something we have in common. We actually, the reason we went to Brooklyn last year was to dig a hole for a treasure.
So, oh, really? To bury one?
No, to try to find one.
Oh, okay.
And we live on the other side of the country, so that was a big trip, but it was fun.
Ah, okay. Was it connected to a particular treasure hunt?
Yes.
One mentioned within your book?
Yes.
Aha.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. It's one of our favorites. It's The Secret.
Aha. Yeah. Yeah. That's a good one. Right. Yeah. I have a funny story about that one, because one of those treasures should be in Boston. And I think I know where it is. Of course, we all think we know where it is.
Mm-hmm.
I strongly suspect, and I've talked to some other treasure hunters, and in this area, it was overturned in a big construction project several years ago. And my strong sense is that all clues point to this place, that no one will ever find it because this area has been basically redone completely. And it's unrecognizable from what it was when I think he buried the treasure there.
Okay.
So,
interesting.
But who knows? Who knows?
37 years has passed, right? Or was it 38?
37 years.
So it's been a long time.
It didn't stop me from going out there several times.
Yeah.
So
that's fun.
We'll see. I would love somebody to find it, but I have a feeling they won't.
Well, you know, it's funny you say that, because our first stop on that trip was in Boston. And we think we know where it is, too.
You do.
And maybe it's in the same spot, because there was some construction
there. There. I was like,
So maybe we'll have to talk about that later. But that's just one of our favorites. And it was fun seeing that mentioned in your book, along with Masquerade.
Yeah, those are two fantastic treasure hunts. Fandango's another good one, too.
I think
this year, if it's not found this year, they're going to reveal where it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, is it? Yeah,
2020?
It's like Thanksgiving Day.
Thanksgiving,
yeah,
that's right.
Thanksgiving 2020. Yeah, so it's like...
Oh, it's 2020.
That's in about a year.
It's coming.
Yeah. Yeah, well...
Yeah, right. I was thinking it was this year, but yeah, 2020.
It's close.
And that's been going on for 10 years, has it?
Is that right? Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah, that's something we have the book. Deidre looked into it quite a bit, but I haven't really studied it. It looks like a fun one.
It's fun. It's hard. Acadia is a tough place, but it's out there somewhere, so
that's
somebody
fun.
Might find it.
Well, I guess we should probably get back to why we're here. Getting back to Trove, how do people participate in your hunt? Do they go out, they buy your book? What?
Well, they'll need the book to participate.
Okay.
So that's the first thing. And they should also subscribe to my blog at sandraamiller.com.
Okay.
And I will be sending clues through the blog. I'll be posting on the blog, but I'll also put them on social media. You can find my social media handles on my website. But you also have to read the book, and it's not going to serve you well to just skim the book looking for clues mm-hmm. that connect to the poem.
Okay.
I think to really be able to solve this, the person's going to have to read the book like a reader for the story
mm-hmm.
and appreciate the story first and see how I approach treasure hunting, because I set this treasure hunt up in the way that I like to hunt for treasure.
Mm-hmm.
So it would really benefit anybody who goes on this treasure hunt. First, read the book and enjoy the story, and then think about the treasure piece.
Okay. There's going to be the hints that are on the blog and mm-hmm. social media, and then you have the book. Now, it sounds like we really do need both things, though, to fully...
Yeah.
Get it, right?
Absolutely. Okay. Right. You'll need to, I'll release the clues every 2 weeks starting September 19th, and then you'll need the book to actually solve the clues. So the clues will be released, and each one will be in a poem. And if you subscribe to the blog every 2 weeks, you'll have a poem in your inbox, and then you can use the book and reference that.
Oh, that's
and
fun.
Also, something a little key to this is the book teaches people how to go on one of these treasure hunts. So it's a little bit of a meta experience where it's self-referencing.
Mm-hmm.
So it's fun because if you're somebody who's never done this before, but suddenly you're intrigued and you want to try it, just by reading the book, you'll learn a lot about how these treasure hunts work and how to engage in one. So that's actually a useful tool. The book teaches you how to look.
That sounds really great. That's something I could recommend to my friends and family that aren't into treasure hunting, to give them an idea of basically what we do and how they can go about getting into it too. Because we try to explain, and some of it just goes in one ear out the other, you know, because sometimes we just provide too much information and it just washes over them, you know?
I know that situation well, yes.
You see them glaze over. Classic treasure hunter move. Like... They're like, give me the highlights.
The eye roll.
Yeah.
The what? What are you looking for? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We've felt that a few times, but that's fine. So does anyone in your family treasure hunt with you?
Well, I went on this treasure hunt with my friend David, who has found some big treasures. And he's solved some key hunt in his time. And so he was really enthusiastic to try this hunt. And I was at a place in my life where I needed to do something to get me out of a rut and some struggles that I was having in other areas of my life that I explore in the book, mostly having to do with my mother and my family. So when David invited me to go on this treasure hunt, I had to make the decision, even though my husband wasn't too enthusiastic about it, I had to make the decision that I was going to go because I needed to do this
mm-hmm.
For myself. And I was absolutely right, because it unlocked so many things for me on many different levels, not just on the physical plane of hunting mm-hmm. for treasure, but on the emotional level. So my husband and my daughter came down to look with me once in Brooklyn. They didn't catch the treasure bug the way I thought they might. So I feel like it's a gene. Maybe you're just born with it or something, that those of us who are just obsessed with treasure mm-hmm. and some people are just not that interested, or this isn't their thing.
Mm-hmm. So I won a treasure hunt back in 2016. And before that, Deidre wasn't interested whatsoever.
Thought it was crazy.
Yeah, like I would wake up early in the morning, go search for this thing, and Deidre would be like, whatever, go have fun, do your thing.
Uh-huh.
Like she didn't try to hold me back or anything. But once I found a treasure and I got a real prize, Deidre was like, oh, this is pretty cool. I could win things. Let's go do this. And so now she's like all in. So it's pretty funny.
Oh, nice. What was the treasure hunt?
It's one that's held in the Pacific Northwest. It's an annual treasure hunt that the city of Portland kind of hosts. It's called the Rose Festival Medallion Treasure Hunt. It's been going on for years. And
ooh, they release a clue a day.
Yeah, they do one clue every day for 2 weeks. It's a lot of fun. It's something that we do annually, and we have lots of friends that we just bump into on the way, because having something in common like treasure hunting, I think those friends that we make there, that's like a really close bond we have with them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's a certain type of person. Oh, that's wonderful. Congratulations. What was the prize? As a treasure hunter, I need to know.
Oh, I won 2 round-trip tickets anywhere Alaska Airlines flies that they were co-sponsor and some other littler things. And we got a ride in the big Rose Parade.
Yeah, we rode in a parade, so had an overnight stay at a resort.
Yeah.
Ironically, he used those tickets anywhere Alaska Airlines flies for going out for another treasure hunt.
I did.
Or not ironically.
Yeah. Or not ironically,
well,
right.
I wish Dietrich could have come with me then. I ended up just using one, and I used the other one on a selfish me thing, too. But I still had fun with it. But now she's in.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Right? It all paid off.
Yeah,
exactly.
Totally. I don't know, I think it's strengthened our relationship, having something that we just talk about these treasure hunts all the time. And sometimes we're just doing things with our kids, and I'll look at her and say something just random that wouldn't make any sense to anybody. And she'll go, yep, you know, we just totally click and gel. So I don't know. It's just a fun thing. I'm glad that we have that. And maybe you just need to go and dig up that cask for the secret. And your family would be in.
They probably would be.
It
wouldn't take much more than that. That's true.
Maybe we could help you with that, because you live in the Boston area, and that's where your treasure is hidden, somewhere in the Northeast in New England, right?
Yes. We'll have to talk off air.
Yes,
for sure. So your treasure, is it buried, or like what is it? What are people looking for?
People are looking for a numbered stone. And it's about the size of a large fist, and it has 8 numbers painted on each side. And they don't have to dig to find it. And when they find it, they will know exactly what it is. It's very likely that somebody would not go looking in this place unless they were specifically following clues.
Okay.
That's my hope anyway. So.
All right. I have a suspicion that a crow picked it up and flew off with it and hit it.
That's awfully heavy.
Could be something like that.
Uh-huh.
And now revealing that you have read my book.
That's okay. Yeah. So did we say it wasn't buried? Is that what I heard?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to make sure I'm clear here. So don't go digging things up.
Right. No digging necessary.
Before we jump into more of your book, I just want to touch one more time on the treasure hunt that I guess this is from your book, because you go on this treasure hunt in the book. You and your friend David, did you guys end up finding that treasure? What happened? And that was a real treasure hunt, right?
That was a real treasure hunt. Yeah, it was called We Lost Our Gold. And you have to read the book to find out what happened to him and what happened to
Fun.
Better hurry up.
Yeah, well,
all will be revealed.
Hey, it's a page turner. You know, I might finish it tonight. You know, when I go to bed, I'll pop it open and take a look at the rest. It's been a fun read. So.
Oh, I'm thrilled to hear that, because you know it also has a heavy side to that story as well. But I try to balance it out with enough about the treasure hunt and other kinds of searching and world travel to bring some levity to the heavier story.
Yeah,
for sure.
All about balance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I grew up in like the 80s and 90s, and I had never heard of the story that you put in the book about this bakery, and there's like a kind of a big crime scene and murders that was nearby where you lived. And you wrote about being a child and being really scared and running from place to place, you know, because you thought they were going to get you. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty scary. The only thing something that in my mind, I can equate that to maybe how the town of Boston felt after the Marathon bombings. In the aftermath of that, there was like a lot of uncertainty. Where are these guys? You know, it just that's what I was kind of thinking when I went through that part of the book.
Yeah, very much so. When you say that, I think, that was the feeling, that there were these killers on the loose and they could be anywhere. And again, here we go, thinking like a treasure hunter, where this clue could be anywhere. I think as a child, I thought these killers could be anywhere in my presence. And I was 10 years old at the time. That was the Donnelly Bakery murder in New Britain, Connecticut. And that was the biggest murder in Connecticut in history until that point. So the largest mass shooting in Connecticut at that time.
Wow.
And it was terrifying. It just shook our town. It affected us for years because the trials dragged on, and then some of us were haunted for decades by it. But it mm-hmm. was very similar to what happened, I think, when we were all sort of on high alert with the marathon bombings. Mm-hmm. But interestingly, at that time, and why I included it in the book, is because that was when my talismanic objects, that these things that I would find that felt like clues and treasure to me, were invaluable, because I felt some safety in these little things that I would find on the ground everywhere. Mm-hmm. So I'd pick up pennies and buttons and paper clips and lighters and broken jewelry. And so in that month when the killers were still at large, I really turned to my trove, my found things, as a place to find some safety.
Wow. You're born a treasure hunter then.
Yeah, yeah. I was.
Yeah. Yeah, that's
yeah,
a heavy
right
story.
In the bone, I think.
What's that?
It's bred in the bone, I think. Father was a treasure hunter, too. He was director of state parks and recreation in Connecticut when he died.
Oh, cool.
But he would comb the beach after storms in his years of working for the park department in Connecticut. And he would find these rings. We had a box of rings in our drawer. In his dresser drawer, he had this box of rings just full of, you know, full of the rings that he found after storms and the broken jewelry he found. So I think I was always intrigued by that as a little girl and loved collecting things, too.
That's really neat. Yeah, I think a lot of that's going on the East Coast right now after that hurricane.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of people are finding some interesting things. So.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, you're friends with Jenny Kyle from Mysterious Writings, is that right?
Yeah, we've had a few phone conversations and we're email buddies. We've never met in person, but we are like-minded, that's for sure.
Yeah, she's super cool. I've actually written a few articles for Mysterious Writings myself about The Secret and a few other treasure hunts.
Oh, yeah, no, she's great. She's really on top of it with her website.
Very wise.
Yeah, we're trying to get her on the podcast one of these days, talk about Mysterious Writings and maybe Masquerade or, you know, some of these.
Oh, yeah, no, she'd be great.
Yeah, she'd be fun. So, yeah, we noticed that an excerpt of your book, Trove, was on the website, Mysterious Writings, and it was dated back from 2015 when that was published. So you've been working on your book for quite a long time.
Yeah, I finished it in 2015, and so I had a full draft then, and she published an excerpt that has since changed, but I've edited it significantly since then, cut back a lot. But yeah, I spent 4 years. I found an agent quickly. That was a long, circuitous route to finding my publisher. So it was a long, hard process, but very much worth it for the place that I landed. So yeah, don't give up. That's the message here. Do not give up. It's like treasure hunting. Mm-hmm. Keep believing that the treasure is out there, that you'll find it. And in my case, it was the right publisher for my book, and I definitely found it with Brown Paper Press.
Good. That's wonderful. Yeah, well, congratulations on getting through that process. And
that's a big accomplishment.
Yeah, the book comes out next week, so we're excited for you.
Thank you.
We were just talking about your trove and your collection, and I had read that the prize for this, the jewels, are from that collection. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah, I've taken apart several pieces of jewelry. Mm-hmm. Well, I had a jeweler take apart several pieces of jewelry that were my own rings or pendants. And we chose 7 stones. So there are 2 sapphires, 2 citrines, a ruby, an emerald, and a pearl that are on this custom-made sterling silver bracelet. And that is the prize in the treasure hunt, which my jeweler says is worth $2,200.
Wow.
It's a real treasure.
It's an exciting prize, and it's a beautiful bracelet. So somebody who finds this will be well rewarded, I think.
Yeah. And the effort that goes into finding these things make them even worth more than that. You know, they're basically priceless to the people that find them and to the people that look. You know, a lot of people will have, you know, some envy over the person that wins that. It's actually a beautiful piece.
Yes.
We've seen pictures.
Thank you. Yeah, I really love it. And I keep thinking, wow, I can't believe I'm giving this to somebody. But that feels right somehow. It feels like the right reward, and it's always wonderful to share our treasures with other people, right? We don't have to hoard them all. We can actually share our treasures with other people in the world who would appreciate them.
Cool.
I love that.
Well, a lot of people work on these treasure hunts alone, but in the book, you worked with your friend. We already discussed that. But when people are out looking for your treasure, do you recommend going alone, finding a good teammate like you did, or maybe working in a group? What do you think is the best strategy?
Well, I went with David because he takes a logical approach to most things, and I have sort of more a creative eye when looking for things. And as he points out in the book, I tend to see unexpected things while he's busy working out the logic puzzles.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a great partnership looking for this treasure. But I feel like this treasure hunting experience is really fun when it's enjoyed with people who appreciate the hunts as well. And I would say part of it is just the experience of being out there, exchanging ideas, looking together, laughing about goofy things, and then when the disappointment hits you, if you don't happen to find it that day after a long day of looking, mm-hmm. you have somebody to share it with and you don't feel so despairing. You can go out for Chinese food and laugh and say, okay, we'll try again next week or tomorrow or mm-hmm. next year, whenever it may be. So I think there's something, it's very companionable thing to do. And I would say find some people who love doing it and go off and find a treasure hunt to follow and start looking together.
I think we should follow this one.
Well, we're going to, for sure.
You absolutely should follow this one.
Yes.
Well, we do have a friend in Boston. We're going to make sure he gets the book, and we will tag team it because we're on the West Coast. But yeah, I like what you said about just finding somebody that you can bounce ideas off of, and that is kind of the yin to your yang, right?
Yeah.
You know, if you're strong in one area, find that other person that could be strong in another area. That's kind of like Deidre and I. We go out and search for all sorts of things, not just locally, but we've gone across the country. And when we're unsuccessful, it's okay. You know, we laugh about it. We enjoy our experience going around and seeing these new things and what could be, what we think are clues. And you know, it's just a fun overall experience. But then when we really are getting super serious, we go to IHOP.
Yes.
That is our place where we have our breakthroughs.
Stuff happens.
Yeah.
It's weird, but everybody has their thing. Apparently ours is IHOP.
Yeah, we have breakthroughs at IHOP. It's wonderful. So a couple years ago, or actually it was last year, there was this treasure hunt called Map of the Dead, and Deidre had the breakthrough of breakthroughs there that enabled us to get one step closer to claiming that prize. It was right after we had IHOP. It was wonderful. We won the runner-up prize for Map of the Dead last year, so that was a big that was an international treasure hunt. So it was completely armchair, though. You didn't have to go anywhere, which was nice, but you had to like study things from all over the world. It was sweet. It was a lot of fun.
Oh, very cool. Very cool. Something about those pancakes. I don't know.
Yeah, right?
So if you ever need a breakthrough, what we're saying is go get some pancakes.
Yeah. You usually don't think of that as brain food, but something, it works on you somehow.
Apparently. This is fantastic. So you mentioned Masquerade and The Secret, as we've kind of said, within your book and working on treasure hunts. Mm-hmm. Are your clues, are they inspired by other hunts? Are they all uniquely kind of your own thing? Or what was kind of the design?
I don't think the clues themselves are completely unique. I can't say no treasure hunter has used this kind of clue before.
Naturally, yes.
I think what is unique is what I mentioned before,
mm-hmm.
that the book teaches you about treasure hunting, and it teaches you how I would look for treasure. And
okay.
How I would bury treasures. So it's a little bit like the Forrest Fenn hunt,
okay.
where you have to think like Forrest Fenn. You have to think like a fly fisherman. You have to think about the outdoors and what he sees in nature and the things he finds unique. I think that's the key to one of the keys to his treasure hunt. So in this way, you'll get a sense of me in the book and what somebody like me would create in terms of clues. And then the clues are hidden in poems. And so that's not unique. A lot of treasure hunts have employed poems as mm-hmm. the clues. But I feel like they do very much capture the spirit of the book. So I feel like I wrote a treasure hunt. I created a treasure hunt. The prize comes from stories in the book. At least the jewels relate to different stories in the book.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like the unique thing about my treasure hunt is how intricately tied the book and the treasure hunt are.
Oh,
in a different way. I don't think anybody's created a memoir quite like this. Again, Forrest Fenn has this mm-hmm. memoir, but I feel like raises the bar a little bit on the idea of a full-length adult memoir spawning a treasure hunt.
Well, I think what's unique about your treasure hunt is you, really. I mean,
no.
It's about you. And I think it's the opportunity for us to look at the world through your lenses. And that's the way we're going to find the path to the treasure. But
exactly. Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. Yes.
I like that.
Yeah, that's really cool. So another thing we learned from your memoir is that you're a world traveler. You've lived on both sides of the United States and kind of all over the world. A lot of that was before you were even 25 years old. Is that right?
Yes. I lived in both Tokyo and Luxembourg before I was 25. I had jobs there and spent four and a half years living in Europe. Yeah.
Wow. Oh, wow.
Do you have any friends left over in Tokyo?
Yeah, I do. I have some close friends still. In fact, one friend, she came and honeymooned in my house in Boston. So
cool.
She wanted to visit me, and she had one big chance after she got married. She and her husband came. I hadn't seen them in years. So I have several close friends still in Tokyo. I taught at a university there, and most of the friends have scattered, but there are still a few there.
Mm-hmm. That's a nice story. I wasn't expecting that. The reason I was asking is because last year, sorry, this is a little aside, but
yeah.
There was like a discovery in Japan about a Japanese edition of The Secret, and it has actual clues in it that it was published after the fact. It's hard to, like, I can't find one. And so...
Are you trying to send her on a treasure hunt for a book?
Yeah, maybe.
If you have connections,
have,
you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I do have connections.
Well, I mean, like, it'd be cool if you can, like, find a copy of the book. It's probably kind of worthless over there, but it's quite valuable over here.
Yeah, interesting. Is it the exact book? Is it just translated, or?
It's translated. It's actually much smaller than the regular book. So right now, if you go to eBay and you try to find a copy of The Secret in English, they're astronomical, like $400, $500, $600.
Okay.
I know that I had a friend buy one of these Japanese editions off of, I think, Japanese Yahoo auctions or whatever for like $10. So, I mean, if you go through a bookstore there, you could probably find one or two. And it's just, they have nice pictures in them. They have just those hints. We have the hints, and they've been translated and whatnot, but it'd just be really cool to have like a copy of that book.
Oh, yeah, sure. I'll put Tomoko Okouchi on it.
Perfect. Put them on the case. I love it.
Yeah, well, that's cool. Yeah, so you've been, like, basically all over the world. So if you were to hide another treasure, like, anywhere in the world, where do you think you'd hide it?
Wow. Well, I wouldn't put it in one of the most beautiful places, because we don't need a lot of people going there. You know, it's funny you say Tokyo. I think it's wonderful to hide treasure in cities and really confuse people. I mean, think about a busy place in Tokyo where maybe, you know, millions of people pass through on a regular basis, and all the flashing neon and the rushing and the technology.
Oh, yeah, we've seen The Amazing Race.
Exactly, right? Right in Shinjuku. How interesting would it be to have a treasure hidden amidst all of that, where it actually required somebody to stop and slow down and
within
really,
that area,
really
yeah.
look. Yeah, I love Japan, and when you say that, that's actually the first place that comes to mind.
Oh,
there's so many great spots for hiding treasure in the world.
That would be super
fun one.
That would be really super cool to get somebody to slow down, like you said, and just take a minute to just observe their surroundings a little bit closer, not be involved in the hustle and bustle. That's a big draw to treasure hunting. It would just be a cool thing to hide in a big, crazy area like that. You're completely right.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like the more obvious place is, of course, off in the countryside, but
nose of a million people passing it every day, that'd be pretty cool.
Exactly.
And so is there anything else you would like to add about your memoir, about this writing process, about the release of The Hunt?
I think this experience has taught me to set your sights on the treasure and just don't quit. Be tenacious about your dreams. I feel like our brains are so busy. We're constantly distracted. It's so hard. It's so hard to pay attention, to slow down in this world. But when we actually slow down, we think about what we want in life. What is our real treasure? Not just the treasure that's buried somewhere in New England or Brooklyn, but what is the real treasure we're looking for? And that's the point of the book that I want people to, that's the thing that I want people to take away from this book, is that your treasure is out there. it's yours to find, and you're the only one who can find it because your treasure belongs to no one else. So whatever that treasure is, whatever that thing you're looking for, maybe it's 10,000 gold coins, or maybe it's somebody to share your life with, or maybe it's good health, or maybe it's a child in your life, whatever that thing is, just don't give up. Don't quit. Follow the path. Follow the clues. Stay engaged and stay interested, and you'll be very surprised at what comes to you.
That sounds like very, very good advice.
Yeah.
You got to just go for it sometimes, right?
You've got to believe, and you've got to go for it. No, you're not going to find it if you don't believe it's out there, right? That happens in armchair treasure hunting, right?
Yeah.
You actually have to hold faith that it's out there. And I've talked to a lot of armchair treasure hunters who say that if you somehow waver in your belief, Jenny says this, then you'll turn away, you'll miss it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you continue to believe, and that applies to armchair treasure hunting or all of the treasures and riches we're looking for in our lives, you have to believe it's out there for you to find, or you're going to miss it if you don't.
Jump in with 2 feet sometimes. Yeah. No risk, no reward.
No risk, no reward. Yeah. Or as Joseph Campbell, right, the mythologist treasure hunter says, where you stumble, there lies your treasure. It's not the easiest thing to find, right? The truth, the most rewarding things in our lives involve going into the darkness, going into a dark cave. So I feel like be persistent. Don't be afraid of the darkness and just keep stumbling. You'll find it.
I'll keep stumbling. That's fine. No problem. I had a kind of a side question. So are you working on any treasure hunts right now? Or like, what are your favorite ones if you are working on any?
Well, it's been a very busy several months getting my book into shape and then setting up my own treasure hunt. And I'm also a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
So I teach writing and journalism at the University of Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been a little bit busy, but the treasure hunt I always have on the back burner is the Forest Fen one.
Mm-hmm.
David and I have played around with that quite a bit and dispatched somebody to the Rockies.
That's a fun
couple
one.
Times, perhaps, to look for it. I followed Jenny's, but I don't usually pursue them too carefully.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really it right now. Creating my own treasure hunt has been so time consuming that I've had to give it my full attention and not get distracted by others. So
it's a lot
I'll
of
be
work
back on it soon enough. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of work. You really have to think in a way that you get a little bit confused when you're setting it up because you think, I know where this is, so all of my clues feel very revealing. Certainly somebody would read this first sentence of this poem and absolutely know where it is.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just me being a victim of having too much knowledge about it, right? So, and of course nobody would figure it out based on this, you know, this first poem. In fact, you're going to need all 8 poems that I release to solve this, I expect.
Interesting.
So you really have to think in a very multifaceted way, and you have to turn it around. You have to think like the finder. You have to think as the treasure hunter. You have to think as the logician. You have to think as the writer of the book. So taking this on was, I will not say it was hard as writing the book. Certainly nothing was as hard as writing this book, but it was a challenge. It was a very big challenge on many levels to create this treasure hunt.
Yeah, we wrote a treasure hunt earlier this year. A clue was put out every couple days. It led to treasure in Oregon. It was actually based on the Goonies, the treasure hunt. And
was it?
Yeah. The first few clues were about pirates, and anybody all over, you know, anywhere in the world can work on it. And a lot of people were thinking that it was in Florida, you know, because of the Treasure Coast down there. And it became pretty obvious later on that it was all about the Goonies, and that's where the Goonies was filmed. And
that's so fun. That is a favorite movie.
Oh yeah, it's
of
so
course.
Good. It's so good.
Yeah.
It was difficult, and that was basically an easy treasure hunt to make. So
yeah, I can imagine going deeper than that.
Yeah, I can imagine.
I can imagine, but it's going to be hard.
Yeah. Right on.
All right. Well, we really, really appreciate you taking time out of your day to talk to us. We know you've been super busy with the book and everything. Where can people get a hold of you?
Well, you can find me at sandraamiller.com. That's my website.
Mm-hmm.
They have that. We'll give them links to my social media. I'm on Twitter at writer Sandra M and on Instagram at sandra.a.miller. And if they subscribe to my blog, they can follow the clues, the book, and search for treasure.
Yay. All right.
Where's the best place to go to buy the book?
You can get it directly from my press, which is Brown Paper Press. and it's available on Amazon. It's available through Barnes & Noble. A lot of stores will be carrying it, and if you go to your local bookstore, which I'm always a fan of supporting, you can ask them to order it for you.
Okay.
So that would be my preferred way of people buying the book, is by supporting the local bookstores.
That sounds
fantastic.
Great. That sounds wonderful.
Great. Well, thank you for having me.
Well, thanks for joining us. It's been an enlightening talk, and we are excited to look for your treasure, and I'm really excited to finish this book.
Excellent. Thanks.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for your time.
You too.
Wow, that was a really great talk with Sandra.
Yeah, I can't wait for her treasure hunt to start.
Me either.
The 19th.
It's coming quickly.
Next week.
Next week. Wow.
We're going to do what we can to figure out what the clues mean. And then, you know, since we have friends all over the country that we talk to about these treasure hunts, we can dispatch one of them to go boots on the ground for us, right?
Yep. Teamwork makes the dream work.
That bracelet's awesome, huh?
Yes. It kind of reminds me of, because it's a handcrafted bracelet and all the intricate work in it and the stones, it makes me kind of think about the masquerade hair.
I can see it.
It's a unique item that's been handcrafted, a real treasure, if you will.
Yeah, so if we find it, or if we can guide somebody to the stone and they can pick it up and we win, are you going to wear it?
Maybe, on a special occasion.
And then it's going to be in our treasure case on the other times?
Yeah, but, you know, you got to take it out for, like, a walk every once in a while, you know?
Is it like a pet?
It is. It's kind of like a pet. You have to take it out to the fresh air, show it off, let it glimmer in the sunlight.
Yeah, sometimes. I remember when I used to take my medallion I found everywhere.
Yeah, that was really annoying.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, I remember. That was so cool.
Hey, I was really pumped.
I was stoked
about it.
And you got it all scratched up because you kept taking it out.
You can buff those scratches out. It's fine.
Oh, okay.
It's cool that she's a forest fen searcher, too. And
yep.
She's into these other treasure hunts like Fandango and The Secret.
Yeah, that makes me excited.
Well, why are you excited?
Because I want to talk to her about them.
I want to talk to her specifically about The Secret.
Well, because you always want to talk about The Secret.
Yeah, well, it's fun.
It is fun.
You know, I'm looking forward to Trove, too. You know, that might be, you tell me all the time I need to, like, pick something else up, work on it a little bit so that I can, if I'm, like, stumped on something with The Secret or maybe another treasure hunt, you know, kind of, like, switch it up a little bit. I think that's what Trove is going to be for me.
Except that you want to talk to the author of Trove about The Secret.
Okay, I do, but, well, she's there and she knows about it. I bet you anything she's thinking the same area as we are.
Yeah, I don't think we could dispatch her to go pick up the stone for the bracelet. So I just don't think that she's going to be willing to do that.
Okay, yeah, probably not.
Yeah, no.
But, we have other friends, and it's cool. I'm excited to talk to her about the Boston puzzle for The Secret.
Yes.
And we'll see where that leads us. Who knows? Just one more time, thanks again. Everybody go find that book. Go to Amazon. Go to your local bookstore. Get your copy. It's going to be a blast, right?
Yes, and don't forget to sign up for her blog so that when the clues are released that go with the book, so it's one clue every couple of weeks that is going to come directly to you. So you're going to want to have those. You're going to want to have the book. Make sure you go get signed up at our website. And of course, we will link that in our show notes so you can easily get there. And you can also follow along the hunt and see pictures of the bracelet on her social media.
Cool.
So join along.
Yeah.
I will be.
It's going to be fun. All right, well, speaking of, you know, we did just talk about The Secret for a moment, right? I think we got a couple voicemails. So thank you for our first callers. So that's pretty exciting. At least one of them, I believe, was about The Secret, right?
Yes.
Hey, why don't we take a listen to it?
Sure.
All right, let's listen.
Hi, I was listening to your podcast. I'd like to discuss the book The Secret with you guys. My name is Rich Sanfratello.
So he wants us to talk about The Secret.
Yes.
What do you think about that?
I think...
like a whole episode just on The Secret.
An entire episode on The Secret. You know, we also got a couple emails about The Secret this last week.
Oh, we did? Okay.
A couple people just wanting us to chat more about it. It's as if we've mentioned it a couple times or something.
Yeah, it's kind of a popular one right now. We do have a Facebook group dedicated to The Secret. I think...
it always gets mentioned on our other podcast.
Yeah, so I think it might be time.
The time is now?
Could be, I guess. I don't know. How about you guys, anybody listening, do you guys want to hear us talk about The Secret? Let us know. And then maybe Maybe we'll do it real soon. Maybe we could talk about our trip to Boston, like in detail.
That would be fitting, considering we are talking about New England and Boston right now. Yeah, and then, seems like a nice little segue.
Yeah, and then maybe we could talk about the New York one another time.
Yeah.
Because we did both in one trip, but each one's its own kind of thing, right?
I mean, they're separate puzzles within the same book. But yeah, I would say definitely different animals within themselves.
So we want to thank Rich for calling us up and leaving that voicemail. Thank you. You're the first one. Appreciate that.
Thanks, Rich.
Thanks, Rich. And yeah, we'll talk about The Secret sometime. That sounds like a good idea.
We're definitely going to put it on our short list.
Do you have any other? There was another voicemail, right?
Yes.
Hi, this is AJ Rainville from West Virginia. I just wanted to say I've been enjoying your podcast, Boots and Armchairs, and I can tell you two have been having a lot of fun making them, and I hope you continue to make more of them in the future.
AJ, I know AJ.
Do you know AJ?
Yeah, AJ was really into breakfast tea and bourbon.
That's right.
At least the riddle. Yeah, he's
which still isn't solved.
It still isn't solved. I fly like a realized bourbon red with a pointy head and feathers on my butt. Where am I?
I thought I was really making progress on that one too. Mm-hmm. And then I stopped. And I'm not sure why.
It's a tough nut to crack.
It is.
It's a hard one.
It's a tough riddle to crack.
Yeah, well, AJ has a YouTube channel that he does his... He has like a little series called Priddle Mondays. He does a live show on Mondays on his YouTube channel discussing different kinds of riddles. And I know he put out a couple of videos about this breakfast tea and bourbon riddle that is still unclaimed, like we said. You know, he had some really good ideas, but it's something that's just super hard and nobody's been able to figure it out. The first person that does figure that riddle out gets a case of Buffalo Trace bourbon. If you like Buffalo Trace bourbon, this could be up your alley. I'll read the poem once again. Like, I haven't memorized, you know, I'm not even looking at anything because I've studied it so much I can't figure it out. But it says, I fly like a realized bourbon red with a pointy head and feathers on my butt. Where am I? And it solves to somewhere in the United States that is a 4-inch by 4-inch square plot of land. Very small, like the size of a coaster. Or mm-hmm. something, you know, something
4 inches by 4 inches, maybe.
Yeah. Like a post, you know, that a lot of people have guessed a lot of different kinds of posts and none of them have been right. Nobody, this has been going on for like 2 years and nobody has figured this out.
Has it been that long?
Yeah.
No.
Yes.
Really?
Over 2 years.
This riddle, just a couple sentences.
Yes. Has not been figured out.
Seriously?
Yeah. Pete is a riddle master or something.
Pete, or maybe we're a riddle fail.
Yeah, we're all riddle failures. But
we're riddled with failure.
Yeah, so what happened was Pete Bissonette, the author of Breakfast Tea and Bourbon. Breakfast Tea and Bourbon was a big treasure hunt that finished just over 2 years ago. And awarded a family $50,000 for finding that treasure. When that was presented, Pete had a little bit of fun with his community that he had built and wanted to give another way for somebody to win something. And so the book called Breakfast Tea and Bourbon, it heavily features the Buffalo Trace brand of bourbon in the book, and he got a case of it to give away to whoever can solve this riddle first. The only problem is it's just too difficult. Nobody can figure it out.
Okay, that feels like a personal challenge. We're talking like two sentences.
Yes.
Okay, this thing has got to get figured out.
Yeah, anybody listening, go to breakfastteaandbourbon.com. It has the riddle there. It even has a few clues. There have been a few clues released, and still nobody can figure this out. Go check it out. Try to figure it out. Email Pete. His email address is right there. I think it's treasure@learningstrategies.com.
Yeah, we'll link up the webpage in the show notes, so okay. You can Perfect. Go in there, click on it.
Solve it.
Solve it.
Let's get it over. Like,
how about you
I want to see somebody
it.
Win.
And then you're going to call our voicemail line. You're going to be like, I solved it.
Yes.
Pete said I did. I'm getting my bourbon. And I'm going to come talk to you on the show. Shouldn't have taken that long.
I bet you we'd get Pete on the show sometime to talk about breakfast, tea, and bourbon.
I bet.
Yeah, that he's definitely on our short list too. So, hey, we want to thank AJ and we want to thank Rich for calling us. If any of you would like to call and just say how much you like us like AJ did or suggest a topic like Rich did, it's easy. Just dial 360-836-4447.
That's right.
All right, call that number, leave us a voicemail, and thanks. What else we got?
I have a review to share.
Oh, yeah? A new one.
A new one. Sweet. From Apple Podcasts.
Oh, cool.
It's a 5-star review.
That's the kind we like.
That.
What does it say?
It, see here. This one's from Jen Crush. Just what I was looking for. As someone who has read and tried to solve many armchair treasure hunts, this podcast was just what I was looking for. Great job. Can't wait for more. Thanks, Jen.
Oh, cool. Well, thank you very much. That's awesome.
Greatly appreciate your reviews, your subscriptions, reaching out to us.
And all that jazz. We can use some more reviews. That's how people get to learn that we're a thing, right?
Yep.
Go to Apple Podcasts and give us a 5-star review.
And tell a friend.
Yeah, tell a friend. Subscribe, share.
You can also find us on social media.
Can you?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
How about on Facebook? Yes. At Boots and Armchairs.
Okay. Yep. That's a good one.
Also on Instagram at Boots and Armchairs.
No.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
I am.
Okay.
On Twitter.
Treasure Hunt Pod, right?
Treasure Hunt Pod.
Okay.
And our website, bootsandarmchairs.com.
Of course. And you can email us at bootsandarmchairs@gmail.com, right?
That's correct. I kind of see a theme here.
I think you said that last time, too.
Maybe?
Because it is a theme.
It is a theme? Boots and armchairs?
Yes.
Okay. Just thought I'd check.
Yeah. Well, one more special thanks to Sandra Miller for being on as our guest. That was an awesome chat. And we look forward to working with you in The Secret. And hopefully you finding us a Japanese edition of the book. We'll pay shipping. It's all good. And go out there and subscribe to Sandra's blog so you get those clues, right?
Yep. And make sure to pick up Trove. Yeah. Comes out on the 19th.
Very soon. So next week.
Thanks for listening to Boots and Armchairs,
a Treasure Hunters podcast. Boom.